think what the video was trying to do is to outline just what we have to offer, and I think all the leaders and the mayor would agree with me that the whole idea of bringing all this together is to try and create those synergies and scale, and you can see what was contained within that, that we have a fantastic offer in the city region. Just to go through some of the steps that we took, so obviously we appointed mayoral advisors in June as we started the progress of setting up the Mayoral Command Authority. We co-opted the Police and Crime Commissioner, chair of the Transport Committee to the Authority. Within months, we were able to have an agreement with the LEP, and the LEP were co-located in this very building. We developed between ourselves a 100-day plan. Not only developed it, but we delivered everything within that 100-day plan because we thought it was important that we demonstrated that we had something to do in the early days. As part of getting out and making certain that nobody was left behind, I attended over 400 stakeholder engagements. They've been events with businesses, large and small, community engagements, volunteering community sector, trade unions, everything. So we've been out and spoke to a wide variety of people. And that culminated when we then set our budget in February 2018. The Combined Authority has made investment decisions, if you have a look at that, totaling £100 million in this first part of our first term. And as part of a wider investment programme, which totals just on £1 billion. So you can see that the money that we've been able to realise from national government started to make a real difference in delivery. On the skills strategy, we, with Councillor Ian May's lead, we developed and approved the strategy for what we need to do in the next 1, 3, 5 years. We've worked on the health programme, on households into work, also invested to the value of £30 million in 40 projects. We've developed the apprenticeship growth plan, and we've got a target of 20,000 apprenticeships by 2020. We are preparing for something that should have been done a long time ago, and we've debated it here, which is the adult education devolution that should have come from national government last year, in a transition year, but we will next year get that devolved down to us, not before time. So things that we've been able to do over and above all that, we're the first in the country to have a standing board, which is a fairness and social advisory board. We were also the first combined authority in the country to sign to be a real living wage employer. And we additionally signed the Armed Forces Covenant and held a mental health summit. And Lucian Verger was working up some really exciting proposals in and around that, which includes our aim to reduce suicides to zero. Now, people might think that's almost impossible. It probably is, but it's a target that we need to look towards achieving, and we'll bring that forward to a future combined authority meeting. On planning and growth, we have now a brownfield register which identifies 400 opportunities on brownfield sites. We have, as a combined authority and each individual local authority area, a brownfield first approach anyway. We secured £300,000 from government to support the planning works on joint work and design quality across the housing portfolio. And we've completed the Shelmore Strategic Housing Employment Landmark Assessment, which is quite a piece of work, but will really be informative in the future when we start to develop our spatial strategy. As everyone I know, I'm just alluded to the fact that we had a match last night to raise funding and also the profile of tackling homelessness and problems with rough sleeping. We secured £7.8 million from the government to develop a housing first approach to homelessness. Some of our councils are involved in best practice in the whole country at doing this. This is additional money over and above that we can use for innovative approaches. We had a housing summit, which was very well received in February, and we've started the work on the housing strategy, and that's well underway, and hopefully will come to conclusion very make sure each, again, you know, report back to the command authority. On our target to improve transport, we've commissioned £25 million worth of enhancements to the Keyring network, which is the most important road as identified with government in our city region. We've also got additional funding for pothole repair, although I'm sure Mayor Anderson will tell you it's a drop in the ocean to what we actually need, and the government really needs to step up to start to help us on that one. We've introduced a fast tag off peak, which is at £1, and we will make further announcements in the next year's budget on achieving my aim of a £1 fast tag. We invested £17.8 million in the Halton Curve, or was it £18.7 million in Halton Curve, and a few jimmies, and I think Liam's going to tease out just actually what that means to us. So, huge investment, but what do we get in return for that investment? And our Transform Cities Capital Award, if approved today, is for £134 million, which we can use on transport initiatives. Business growth and innovation, again, we've got huge opportunities. The International Business Festival in 2018, just in a month's time, will be held just around the corner, which is the biggest, largest gathering of businesses globally. So we really need to capitalise on those opportunities. We've got something called LCR Activate, which is £5 million to support growth of digital and creative businesses. Again, for those organisations who have benefited from that, hugely beneficial. We invested in Alston North West Technology Centre, maybe £5 million in total, including some stuff for apprenticeship revenue, and funded Securus, which is the world's second largest influenza vaccine manufacturer. Greg Clark came to launch that with us. We've also started work on a city region full fiber network initiative, and that will provide, hopefully, ultra-fast digital connectivity across the whole city region. I think this is part of the fourth industrial revolution stuff that Phil will be picking up, which really is very exciting for us because we have the Hartree supercomputer, we have high bandwidth linking. If we can join those things up, it means we can do big data analytics and lots and lots of interesting stuff. And I think we, as a city region, can lead the UK in that respect. On culture, again, I don't know if anyone came to Liverpool City over the last few days, but what a showcase that was, and congratulations to Joe and to the cultural team at Liverpool. But we also supported that with £5 million worth of funding. I just think that it displays everything that we know about what the city region is about. The culture and creative strategy, which was designed, developed, and got approval by Phil Davis. That is one of the elements of it, is to ensure that 1% of our game share funding will be allocated each year to support local cultural events in the borders. So we'll do it around Robin. People will have turns to piece on that, and it'll give a focus to what we can do in regard to culture at a much wider basis. Liverpool obviously leads on this. I'm sure that they will be sharing best practice. And around the 10th anniversary of Capital Culture, there are a number of other planned spectaculars, and perhaps a future date. I think, Joe, if you want to take us through that, but it includes the Giants, and I think that's the one that everyone's really most excited about. For a cleaner, greener, and more resilient Liverpool City region, Rob Polehill is helping us with the entire commission to look at the possibilities of harnessing the power of the River Mersey, whether a lagoon, a bridge, a barrier, a bylaw, whatever that project might be, to ensure that we put a business case forward so that we can attract local government support. 70% of our bus fleet now is low emissions, one-fifth of those powered by electricity. But we want to go further, and Liam, with air quality as part of his portfolio, will be looking at how we can enhance what we already have. And as a feasibility study, that's been undertaken to look in depth at poor air quality, by the way, across the city region. And we've got funding which is already secured for an energy strategy. That will include stuff Rob will be talking about, which is photovoltaic, it's hydrogen, it's wind, it's the stuff that we're doing on the tiles. So it's all different aspects that we can really, I think, exploit. The aim is to become Britain's renewables coast, so we think we can do that for energy. Looking ahead then, of course we all are cognizant of what's happening with Brexit, or what's not happening with Brexit, and the fact that the channels that we have to deal with potential governments are clogged up with stuff around Brexit. But we've got the opportunity of what's called a sounding board. So we've met with, I met with David Davis, who's the Brexit secretary, and we are making certain that our voices heard both locally and across the north, because there needs to be a differential settlement for this area. The one thing we can't do is allow the Brexit settlement to be predicated on what's in the best interest of the South East, or dare I say it, the City of London. So the next stage in what we're going to do is to develop our local industrial strategy, and we are in the process of commissioning that piece of work, working with the LEP and other partners to ensure that we get the right people and that it aligns very much with government thinking, so that we can start to look at the opportunities of getting additional funding to supplement some of the advantages that we have, and some of the, certainly the innovative growth areas that we know are unique to our city region. We're going to continue to deliver cultural events. We've got skills, someone has to say IFB in 2018, and famous, if you like, we are in the process with FASGAB, the Exit Social Justice Advisory Board, to develop a fair employment charter. And we think, again, that will be the first combined authority of the country to be doing that. One of the big things I think everybody, both Phil, Joe, myself, have pushed is the need for us to be connected into large infrastructure projects nationally. High-speed south-north, but also west-east connectivity is really important to us and to our futures, and we've really started to push that home. Working with our colleagues in Greater Manchester, we've secured additional funding for touchpoints, £100 million for touchpoints, which means that in the future we can get connected into HS2. But the government really needs to start working with us and with Transport for the North, and there is an event which coincides with the convention. The Convention of the North, that myself Mayor Anderson spoke at a conference call with Northern leaders, and that's one of the big pushes for Transport for the North. We need to ensure that we aren't missed off as usual from national government. We are delivering the adult education budget and household to work programmes. We will certainly be, once adult education budgets are fully devolved to us, but we're working, students working to develop some of that. There is progress around devolution, but we identify that we need somebody who's specifically responsible for that. That's why Graham Morgan has been appointed into that portfolio to really start to take that forward to achieve further funding and powers. And this digital infrastructure action plan is probably the big prize for us. If we can get that one over the line, there's a genuine opportunity for us to be a national leader on that. And progress has been made, for instance, in development fund loan for businesses. So we're looking at where we can draw down additional government funding so that we can help our local businesses and the indigenous organisations within the city region. So, lots done in 12 months. But of course, we are only at ground zero. We know that this year needs to be about delivery think 100% of our time, and certainly now that people have set up portfolios, I think it will be a challenge for us to have updates from those portfolio holders on the progress that they're making. This has to be about delivery, as we all know. There's a gateway process in 2020, and we want to continue with devolution, we want to continue with enhanced devolution. So really, I'd say where we were to where we are now, it's a really good first year report, and that's a review of the first year of the Mayoral Combined Authority. Are there any questions, or anybody wants to add anything specific to that lengthy presentation? No? Okay, cool. Move on. Item 9 is the business section. So again, apologies, it should be the same as last time.
Yeah, that's the same as last time.
Declarations from members, be the same as last time. Minutes of the meeting with the Combined Authority held on the 20th of April 2018. Can I ask if they are agreed, please?
Agreed.
12, we'll do that next time. It's 13 is the annual governance statement, which forms part of the governance framework of the Combined Authority. And this is required to be approved today, and it will form part of the annual accounts. And Sarah Johnson's going to take us through this report.
Thank you, Chair. This report presenting to the local city region Combined Authority, the annual governance statement for 2017-18. It's a key element of the authority's governance framework, which takes the form of self-assessment against the Sit for Solace framework. The AGS is appended to this report. Now, the annual governance statement needs to be approved by the Combined Authority, at which point it becomes combined in the authority's statement of accounts and is then subject to external audit. If anyone has any particular questions, they'd like to ask them back.
Any questions for Sarah? No? We agree the recommendations then, which is set out on page 237. 14 is the internal audit and risk management documents, which form part of that governance framework of the Combined Authority. And those documents are presented for approval. Sarah McGain will take us briefly through this.
Okay, thank you, Chair. This report is providing an update on the proposed internal audit arrangements for the local city region combined authority for 2018-19, and it provides detail on the ongoing development of a risk register. There are a number of documents that have been alluded to for approval, and these are the proposed plan for internal audit work for 2018-19, the internal audit charter and quality assurance improvement programme, and the draft risk management strategy. Again, I don't intend to go through these in any detail, but anyone's got any questions, we have to take them.
Any questions for Sarah? Okay, can we agree the recommendations to set up on page 253 then, please? Item 15 is a report subject to conditions which seeks approval for a full business case in relation to Shakespeare North Warehouse and Prescott Rail Interchange and public realm improvements. Appendix 2 and 1 and 2 to this report set out the details of the two full business cases. And is Mark here? Mark's going to take us briefly through, and then I think Councillor Morgan wants to do that.
Thank you, Chair. So the paper presents two halves of a whole, and the whole is aimed at generating economic growth through culture in Prescott Town Centre. One half comprises support for the Shakespeare of the North Theatre and Education Facility, and the other half presents transport improvements around the train station and into town that are aimed at improving both access and accessibility. The CA is looking forward to working with the NOSI team over the course of the summer as we progress towards signing legal documentation for both projects. I won't go into details unless you have questions. Thank you.
Just before the questions, Councillor Morgan, you wanted to add asking things to say.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Colleagues, this Shakespeare Theatre has been 20 years in the planning. This investment decision will deliver yet another world-class visitor attraction and education centre to our wonderful city region. This playhouse completes the Bard's Triangle with the Globe in London and the Royal Shakespeare in Stratford and will attract visitors from across the globe. You have my assurances that this iconic cultural beacon in our region will receive its first visitors and students in October 2020, the year mostly celebrated being the Mother of Culture. Just moving on, Chair, to the Prescott Rail Station and Public Rail Project. The station improvements with the much needed step free access and car park extension will benefit all our residents and visitors. The new wayfinding signage and walking cycling route from the station to the new hotel, theatre, restaurants and a safari park really connects the growth generators across the town. We want to create a weekend destination for Prescott, and this investment enables us to do just that for all our residents, visitors and investors. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Any questions?
Thank you, Chair. I can't find any detail about who is the creative or academic lead on the project. And you mentioned a master's degree programme, similarly, who will be awarding that. As far as I know, my university, University of Liverpool, hasn't had any engagement with the project, and I think we would like to.
Thank you. As I understand, discussions are ongoing with John Moores University.
That's absolutely fine, but it's a little bit opaque since it is a creative endeavour in terms of who is leading on the creative and creative efforts.
Frank?
Thanks, Chair. Speaking on behalf of Moses, so Greg, please jump in if you think this is inappropriate. I think Mark's right, the discussion today has been with Liverpool John Moores University, but I would expect that Moses would be more than happy to have further discussions with Liverpool University to explore the possibility of getting even more support for an iconic investment of this nature.
Okay, in that case, can I ask Mark to liaise with Janet to make sure that that happens? I'm sure Graham is one of your parts of it. Yep. Any other questions? Can we agree the recommendations then set out on page 317? 16 is a report which seeks approval, believe it or not, to accept £134 million, what's called Transforming the Cities Fund from the Department for Transport. And a third report will be presented to a future meeting which sets out the principles and the priorities for developing those funds. But Councillor Robinson is going to briefly take us through what this could be useful.
Yeah, very simplistically, she just stated effectively it's accepting the £134 million that can be used for a variety of different transport projects, particularly those linked to sustainable public transport, particularly focusing on things like walking and cycling measures as well. I think the other key point to point out within the report is point 3.4, which just explains the spending profile that we will be getting this in tranches over the next 4 years. As part of the offer, we'll need to make sure that all of the work is carried out and money utilised within that four-year time period.
Yeah,
that's
to add for inefficient information for reports and future on the likes of it. As you just said, you know, it's a question of us taking the fund and the 130 million welcome closing to. It would also be good to contrast that on loss. And so, you know, whether in the report we just highlight what we used to be able to access in terms of funding. Just so people can see at the end of the day, it's 130 million, but we maybe used to get 400.
I think it's a point well made. It's like the £30 million we get a year in 2045 when we draw down our last shortage of money, which will be £900 million. To date, we've had £1.5 billion cumulatively taken away from us. So even in 2045, we're not going to have achieved what's already being taken from us. So I think it's a good compare and contrast. Any other questions on that?
Thanks, Chair.
Jane just wanted me to re-impress onto the authority the importance of using the funds. So Liam said there about walking and cycling, but anything we can do to try and use this to improve road safety, because we know it's a real challenge for the city region. So if we can consider that, that'd be great. Thanks.
Yeah, and I don't know the members on the way in received some letters here from some people who are lobbying outside exactly on that fund, so it's an important point. Can we therefore agree the recommendations as set out on page 329?
Agreed.
17 is a public question time, and we've not had any questions from the public on this occasion. For 18, we have had our first petition. It's in regard to the cancellation of the 135 and the 235 Liverpool circular, which has been signed by 89 people. And the petition will be referred to the Transport Committee because it's a specific transport issue. So it goes to the Transport Committee for their consideration and will provide a written response within 10 working days. On 19, which is the minutes of the Transport Committee held on the 5th of April, can we confirm the minutes of that meeting? Item 20 is an urgent item, which is consent to the draft Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Business Rate Supplements Functions Order 2018, for someone to say. So it needs to be included and consented by close of play today. So Frank, if you could just briefly through that.
Thank you, Chair. And apologies for bringing this forward as an urgent item, just the time constraint placed on us by government and the requirement to get approval from each of the local authorities for the combined authority in essential. We had to bring it here today to be able to comply with the deadline from government. So what the report is looking for is consent of the City Region Combined Authority, making the order of the Secretary of State to confer onto the Combined Authority the powers of the Business Rate Supplements Act 2009 to be able to levy business rate supplements on businesses in the City Region. Critical that it's understood within this is that the CA cannot do this without holding a referendum to the businesses that are affected, and the businesses that are affected have to agree with the proposals that are put forward in a majority sense. So this is enabling the power to be held by the City Region, but we would need to go through the referendum process before we're able to apply that power. Happy to take any questions, but otherwise I'll be referring to the recommendations as much as possible.
Is there any questions? Can we therefore agree the recommendations are set out on page 1 of the supplementary agenda pack? So the next meeting of the Combined Authority will take place on Friday the 29th of June 2018 at 1 o'clock in the Council Chamber. I've had no other indication of any other urgent items, so I declare the meeting closed and thank you for your attendance.